Time's up. Game over. The fat lady sang a long time ago. By now, like the forewarned elite of global capitalism's old boys network, she probably packed up her troubles in her old kit bag, grabbed a few donuts and on the way to cash her chips in. That, and watch the birds and banks of our planet go into free fall. The shift in the balance of powerful forces are evidently affecting the entire planet, the global environment, birds, fish, animals and insects, en masse. And for people, the effect of socio-cultural and economic polarization is becoming increasingly hard to avoid, let alone ignore. People are becoming polarized. The times are presenting frequent and unavoidable crisis points where people are having to make decisions, tough ones. It's happening across the world, from Egypt to England, and Algeria to America. It's polarization, and in its extreme form people are in the streets deciding which side of the barricades they should be on, coming to a street near you soon. Or not. Either way, unless or until then, all anyone can do is carry on eating the chips. Until they are down. Down to the point where the food supply and distribution infrastructure grinds to a halt. Then, all bets are off. When man finds out that he can, most definitely, live by bread alone. When gold and diamonds are worth less than potatoes and corn. And when we find out if the old adage was right, the one about the world being always just 3 meals away from revolution. It's not the end of the world. It's just time to take the world back. Back from the men who stole it, and then had the gall to sell it back, again, and again, and again. For generations. But always for a profit. So it's not the end of the world. A world that for thousands of years has been treated as a commodity, governed by scientific materialism, and exploited by global capitalism. And for 99% of the people whose loss has always been profit, for the 1% who form the ruling elite of that system, it should be the start of a new age of creative power that will come from a share of ownership and global responsibility and global unity. Forgive. Sure. But forget. Well, we'll see about that. Lest anyone forget, there has been thousands of years of inhuman abuse, disregard for life, rape, exploitation, invasion and do what the hell we want and take what the hell we want attitude. Okay, maybe tough times are ahead for those who have had too much of a vested interest in maintaining the current global economic system of money laundering, stock market rigging, government-subsidized bank bailouts, and other forms of global finance corruption. And for the worst of global capitalism's parasites, the old boys network, it's certainly not going to be easy adjusting to a world where the elitism, nepotism and old Etolonian, huyanuism, is not as important as, hey buddy, you can get in the queue like the rest of us isums. So although it's easy to forgive a capitalist pig, after all, he can cry just as much as the pig he sold to the butcher. But it's not so easy to forget that he consoles his grief tonight dining on truffles and caviar, bought from the profits of bacon. And in a world governed by materialism, there is unavoidable erosion and loss of human compassion and spirit of humanity. Such have become alien, too much of mankind, and at the expense of truffles, caviar, Nike trainers, and must-have mobile phone, life is comparatively cheap. Customers should note, the price paid for a soul can vary. And refunds do not apply. Of what may possibly exist in the cosmos that could come to harm us, nothing in man's imagination could possibly be more inhuman, or more inhumane, than a holocaust waged upon the world of an entire sentient species, by the same sentient species. With inhuman abuse, disregard for life, rape, exploitation, invasion and do what the hell we want and take what the hell we want attitude. A planet where wars, suffering, starvation, slaughter, rape, theft, Abuse and invasion is taking place right now on this planet, and it is a war we wage against all forms of life we share the planet with. What kind of alien would commit such atrocities to its own kind? What kind of intelligent life is out there in the cosmos that would deplete the environment of its homeland? What sentient life form sells off its own natural reserves and wipes out other life forms who happen to be living where the next mining of depletion program comes along with their inhuman abuse, disregard for life, rape, exploitation, invasion and do what the hell we want and take what the hell we want attitude? What kind of life form that has evolved to the stage of knowing the value, rights and celebration of love, freedom, education and civilization, could avert their eyes, turn their backs, turn up the volume, and allow such abuse, disregard for life, rape, exploitation and invasion and to happen? Of whatever may exist in the cosmos that could come to harm us, maybe there is nothing more alien to mankind than its own sense of humanity. And surely, we could not encounter any species that could threaten our extinction with such reckless disregard for the life of our planet than a close encounter of the worst kind. The close encounter with our own kind. And how many abductees live the life as a human battery? How many recharge their cells by eating cows, whilst they watch commercials selling more new products, made in sweatshops powered by other human batteries? Expendable units of power, used for the purpose of extracting that power, discarded and replaced by fresh batteries. Who is being abducted? Who is the abductor if not the most inhuman of beings, with their inhuman abuse, disregard for life, rape, exploitation, invasion and do what the hell we want and take what the hell we want attitude? Using life forms as objects to exploit, farm or harvest, those invaders with their do what the hell we want and take what we want attitude, it is alien to human civilization. Do the other batteries recall under hypnosis experiences where they are made to endure and suffer such inhuman abuse? Maybe, if they are living it and experiencing it every day of their lives, they don't need any help or assistance to know it is inhuman to be exploited. And they probably realize only too well that being seen, used and discarded in terms of being an expendable unit of energy in a system of production, is alien to any civilization. They don't need hypnosis or any Goffman-esque Jungian symbolic interaction to be aware of the problem. But it doesn't sell many books, and it won't get much interest in the abduction and contactee conference circuit. So what are the aliens of our world actually saying here, with their inhuman abuse, disregard for life, rape, exploitation, invasion and do what the hell we want and take what the hell we want attitude? What is behind the dark staring eyes that the greys have? They are iconic. But look again, and from their perspective somewhat ironic, because now there is a catch. Catch 22. Are they staring? Or are they reflecting? Such entities appear to be part of the nuts and bolts and flesh and blood phenomena. Sometimes appearances can be deceptive, draped in their inherent symbolism. The highly strange non-human beings that invade the territory and space of humans and subject and force them to experience an imposition of such inhumanity, with their inhuman abuse, disregard for life, rape, exploitation, invasion and do what the hell we want and take what the hell we want attitude. It is something alien to human civilization. But what they have in common with goblins and elves is something in common with our own selves. Such entities, whether they appear in the form of imps, elves, djinns, dragons, goblins, sprites, familiars, pixies, fairies, angels or aliens, they have devoted themselves to draw attention from the material world that we assume to rule and onto a world that turns the table and the rule. They repeatedly remind us that doing unto others as we expect others do unto us, where mankind's way of doing unto other life on the planet, is not something mankind expects to be done unto mankind. A reminder, if left ignored, may also become quite literally, mankind's own worst nightmare. If borne in mind, literally, Then bear in mind also that there is a highly symbolic and ironic nature that appears to be inherent of abduction experience. Almost identical, if not similar to psychological expression, projections, symbolism of behaviors, dreams and interpretation. It would indicate that a Jungian psychoanalytical hypothesis would posit that social and cultural psychological conflicts are processed and projected back as expressions of highly symbolic formation. Loosely, as Carl Jung suggests, the symbolism human consciousness projects into dreams can be projected into the so-called real world. Jung's hypothesis of such projected thought forms is neither unusual or unique. In other cultures, such thought forms are not called aliens, UFO, elves, or goblins. They are called tulpa. And if you consider the fact the term highly symbolic is something which belongs to that part of the UFO and alien phenomena which, rather than being nuts and bolts or flesh and cartilage, is instead commonly referred to as highly strange, then perhaps the nature to the seemingly very inhuman relationship some of the entities have with humans is not as strange as it seems. It may be even stranger. Shakespeare said, "The world is a stage." Then, considering postmodern manuscripts and post-quantum literature, the question about alien abductions is more than just a play on words. To be, or not be, human, is an act of human kindness. But that the act of conscious observation influences the state of the particles of energy which form matter, that may be more than Shakespeare, literally, thought possible. If humans are responsible for acts of such creative potential, it is often at the stage that angels fear to tread. So maybe, what potentiality there is to any possibility that a post-quantum Jungian midsummer night dream, or mayor, exists, is an outcome that implies by its very nature, that it should, in all probability, remain at this point in space-time, non-local and perchance beyond imagination. But then that's some catch. Ooh.